By the time that you are watching this, we will know what happened to Ison going around the sun. But the trouble with Ison is when it goes over the Earth. Okay, if that should happen. However, there's something way more important than Comet Ison. Way more important. And this was revealed to me this morning in clarity. And this is the astonishing fact that we have been tripped up on for so long. I tell you this, that all karma, all tendencies, everything, it is all bad. It is all, give it all to the, what I call the karma guru. It's like, let's say you have a bank account and you have this money. Well, let us say that you are engaged in a quest seeking a lost treasure, which doesn't exist. And in this seeking, in this focus, you only get yourself into trouble. Very bad trouble, a lot of the time. Now, all this money in your bank, you're using it to finance your quest. And so really, this money is really being used to inflict suffering upon yourself. What the karma guru does is you give all your karma to the karma guru. It's like you give your entire savings account of acquisitions in your long search for this treasure. You give it all to the guru. And then the guru will, like a trustee, apportion stuff to you that is actually used in a benevolent way. Because the guru is not searching for lost treasure. You see, the motivation is completely different. They know that our one treasure is everywhere. So, the problem we have been caught in is we keep trying to get rid of our bad karma and accumulate good karma. That is what has tripped us up. There's no such thing as good karma. It's all bad. It's all harmful. So, give it all to the karma guru. The good and the bad and the ugly, all of it, entirely, to the trustee, acting as a trustee. Trustee is someone who's responsible for the funds, helping out someone who's not yet developed that responsibility. Trusteeship. So that is how to go about it. We tend to hold on to what we think is our good karma. Really, all karma is designed to try to kill ourselves, to try to destroy ourselves. I say this existence is a training program, trying to, a death-based training program, trying to destroy what we are, trying to dispossess ourselves entirely of our one treasure. We don't have many treasures, we have one treasure, but it's everywhere. It's everything, it's everywhere. And we're trying to dispossess ourselves of that by searching for another treasure. We say, well, yeah, that treasure's great, but we want something better. So we're on a search to find something better. So all karma arises from this search, all of it. So ultimately, we don't want any karma at all. We don't want any tendencies, dynamics, momentum. How can you be aware that your treasure is everywhere right now if you have momentum towards acquiring, seeking anything? How can you be aware of it? You won't. It blinds you to it. Karma is like the great blinding of ourselves. We blind ourselves to our treasure. So we're like blind people desperately searching for treasure. We want to see our treasure, but we blind ourselves. So all we do is frantically searching. It's like someone with their eyes closed, searching for sight. And all they need to do is open their eyes. And yet, that's what they don't do. Our karma is like closing our eyes and keeping our eyes closed and then searching everywhere for sight. Where is sight? Is sight over here? Is sight over here? Up there? Down there? Around there? Somewhere in space and time, I'm going to find sight. Just open your eyes. But the will to search blinds us. The will to search blinds us. So Karma could be said to be the will to search. We have this will to search. That blinds us to the fact that we already have it. So the true gurus, there's no search there. They're aware of their treasure, that it's everywhere. So in their hands, karma can be used as grace, okay, but not in our hands. Not in our hands. First, we have to open our eyes, you see. So the guru helps us open our eyes by taking the karma off of our shoulders and then apportioning it to us in the appropriate way. Now, don't give your karma to the goddess of greed. You know, that is the motive, the ego, the motivating factor who tells us to search more, you're almost there, keep searching, search more, search harder, you got to put more effort into your search. That's the goddess of greed who wants you to accumulate things and powers and controls and everything and give it to her. And then she says she'll be the new god of a new kingdom for us. But in the meantime, you're wrecked upon the rocks, constantly wrecked upon the rocks of this terrible search. It's greed, 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 greed. Accumulation, more, want more. Of course, the one whose eyes are closed wants to feel more things, more things, more things, more things, more things. I need more. I still can't see. I need more. Right. Well, you're never going to see unless you open your eyes, and you're never going to experience your treasure unless you drop the search to find it, because it can't be found. Because it's everywhere. How can you find everywhere? Where is there to search for it? Any search blinds us and deludes us. So karma is the momentum of the search, okay? It is the momentum of the search. Don't hand that over to one who wants to increase your momentum. That is going to cause you the most severe regrets and problems. Hand it over to the perfect, the true guru. Okay, and I am not a guru at all, not even a teacher. I'm just somebody along the path who's gone through a lot and is aware of some of these pitfalls and snares and difficulties. So I'm gonna encourager, reassurance, try to bring reassurance and encouragement, like an old elder brother, but certainly not a guru. So don't give it to me. Don't try to give your karma to me. That's I don't want it. Don't want your good karma. Absolutely not. That's the trick. Again, good karma is also the same as bad karma. It's momentum in the search. Okay? You don't want any momentum in the search. But how do you wind down that momentum? That's called the continuity problem. We don't want to go from all this momentum in the search to no search at all. We feel we'd be freaked out. So the continuity problem is our only problem. How do we let this search, momentum of the search, wind down? Giving all your karma to the karma guru, the perfect karma guru, that's a huge step in that direction, because then they can help wind it down for you in practical ways, in pragmatic ways. I mean, most of us still want to act like we have some momentum, right? Well, we want to go places, do things, etc. Very few of us are prepared to, you know, culturally just, you know, sit in a cave in inner absorption for the next 30 years. So, you know, so there is a practical side to it, to a continuity issue. There's always a practical, pragmatic side to it. The karma guru understands this, and they will allow you to continue to, you know, they'll apportion it like a trustee, so you're able to continue to live your life, all the while toughening you up for truth, meaning putting you in better and better situations where you are getting ready really for the death-free realms, where everything is ever fresh. Everything is ever fresh. So this is better than Ison, isn't it? This is an incredible thing to say Because what we're trying to do is hoard our good karma and get rid of our bad karma. That's the mistake we make. Or give our karma to the wrong place. Which probably all of us at one point will do. Because the goddess of greed is very, very tricky. And you think that your problem is that you're not searching effectively enough. That is not the problem. The problem is that you're searching at all. That's the problem. So you don't need more effective searching. You need to be able to drop the search, to wind it down, to say, not by finding the object of your search, but by realizing the object of your search can never be found. Because we only have one treasure, and it's everywhere. So again, how can that be found by a seeker? Because that implies that there's a seeker, there's something that doesn't have it right now. That is somehow without it. So as long as there's a seeker, you're going to feel like you're without your treasure. You feel like the treasure is somehow missing somewhere. And then you have the subject-object duality of a search. So the grace of the perfect karma guru, they have endless grace because they have an infinite treasure. And they use your karma that you give them like a great trustee apportioning it out to you. And so all the future karma you have, you give it all to them, and then they will use whatever is effective for you. And plus they have infinite effectiveness of their own, to supplement whatever is needed. So this is a concept that needs to get into your consideration. It's an incredible concept. Once you actually hand over all your karma, your life is essentially safe. You're essentially protected and safe. But as long as you are holding on to your good karma, you're not safe at all or protected at all. Because you are going to be searching. And when you search and are seeking for your lost treasure, inevitably you're going to be frustrated and you want advice as to how to search better. And immediately that brings the goddess of greed into the picture. That egoic motivation that seduces and tricks and makes false promises to you, tells you whatever you want to hear, and then you'll end up being enslaved by that and seeking for them, for that, trying to enrich that at your own expense, thinking that then you're going to get something back, and you never get anything back. That's been my experience. You don't get a penny back. You don't get anything back. All you get is suffering. So inevitably, your good karma leads you to suffering. Any search will lead you to suffering. Unless you place your karma in the hands of the true karma guru, who then knows how to deal with this continuity issue, having themselves no motive for search whatsoever. They can truly know how to wind your search down, instead of augmenting it, instead of intensifying it. The goddess of greed intensifies your search. The karma, the true karma guru, de-intensifies your search. Even if the goddess of greed appeared with all her dakinis and consorts and shakti and all this stuff in the most beautiful array, etc., to me right now, I'd say, forget it, go to hell, because that's the only place where you're going to find anyone who's going to follow you. Not interested. I don't care how glamorous she might appear. Because only in hell, meaning hell is the place of searching, Only there will she find those who are willing to follow her, you know, terrible program. Because those who are wising up, they're getting out of hell. They're getting out of the search. Hell, the search is hell. That is what, so when you talk we're dwelling in hell. We're dwelling within the context of this searching for our lost treasure. That is hell. That is what's called the dead. We're dead to our treasure. We're unaware of our treasure. So it's like it's a living death, a desperate search. That's hell. So we need to get out of hell. And you only do that by dropping the search. And how do you do that? You have to wind it down. Like a ceiling fan that's been going really fast. You take off the electricity to it, and gradually it winds down. You don't just suddenly put your hand up there and try to stop it. You know, it's too abrupt. We don't want a super abrupt ending. We want a soft landing to this. The karma guru gives you a soft landing. That's the purpose. So the goddess of greed, no matter how beautiful she may appear, how glamorous, how powerful, how all-knowing, all etc., she's only there to intensify your search. Only there to, that's her only purpose, is to intensify your search, which leads you into the most horrific suffering. More intense the search, as they say, the bigger they are, the harder they fall. The greater the search, the more intense your suffering is going to be, for sure. And you can see the world is just incredibly under the spell of this goddess of greed. And what we're told, this goddess of greed has put out this marketing campaign throughout the whole globe. And it's what we're told, the planet's told, is that we don't need the karma guru. We don't need God's grace. What we need is this goddess of greed as personified by the feminine component in the world. And so we're told that women have the answer to our salvation. The feminine has the answer to our salvation. No, they don't. What they are doing unequivocally is intensifying our search. It is absolutely obvious to anybody who's willing to look at it. Is there's this tremendous enfoldment back into an intensification of the search. That's called the fourth dimension. We are ready to shift into the fourth dimension. Now, ISON is actually a cosmic trigger bringing about the shift into the fourth dimension, the end of the third dimension, the shift into the fourth dimension. That's actually what's happening. There's no question about that. I know this to be a fact. And so the shift into the fourth dimension occurs from an intensification of your search. Okay, and the goddess of greed, with all her ladies in waiting, have permeated the planet with this advertising campaign to make us to try and wreck our aspirations to turn to the true karma gurus, because there are quite a few. But the basic principle behind them is the grace of God. They're trying to wreck our aspirations to turn to the grace of God and instead turn to their type of motivation, which is glamour in all its many guises, to intensify our search, okay, for our lost treasure. This intensification of our search is what propels us into what's called the fourth dimension. Now, this got underway back in the 60s, the 70s. This advertising campaign began to be in earnest, really strongly, because what happened was there are many people throughout the world who were turning to the grace of God, to turning to the true karma gurus, and they began to de-intensify their search. That's what the 60s was all about. They say, hey, we've had enough of this search, forget it. You know, and there was a great search for these karma gurus, like a Ramana Maharshi, like an Anandamayi Ma, like some of the great Tibetan masters, etc., all over the planet, and also Jesus Christ. And we were really trying to find, you know, the answer. He said, we don't want to keep searching. We're tired of this search. What happened was there was this enormous backlash from the goddess of greed, which gave rise to what I call feminism, radical feminism, which was really designed to demonize these aspirations of dropping the search, especially demonizing the whole male thing, because a lot of men were dropping out in two or three cars. They want their children, their grandchildren. They want to be happy and prosperous and sent to the right universities, all this stuff. In other words, to intensify the search. A lot of women are this way. And they saw a lot of men dropping out and saying, forget it, I'm finished with the search. And it freaked them out, totally freaked them out. And this is then you had this rise of radical feminism that said, what you're doing is wrong, you're evil, men are terrible, they're evil, they're under the spell, wicked spell, don't listen to them, they have nothing to say. And there's this nonstop campaign now that said men are stupid idiots, they have nothing valuable to say whatsoever. All of this is designed to wreck this aspiration towards grace. And there are also a lot of women who wanted to stop the search too. Okay, they also got demonized. And so we have this situation now where the goddess of greed with her ladies-in-waiting are very much in charge, in very high positions now, okay, throughout the globe, key positions. The men are just shadow puppets for this goddess of greed now. And the whole thing in this world is to push into the fourth dimension where they hope they're going to be free of this aspiration to turn to the true karma gurus, to turn to the grace of God, to turn our karma, to turn the search over to our karma gurus, and let the search wind down. They believe they're going to be free of it there, and they will be largely cut off from it, as it were, or at least in their beliefs they will be, which is why you have this rise of atheism now, billboards all over the place now, you know, who needs God? This guy in Sacramento, there's all these billboards. It's a worldwide movement. That's all fourth dimensional. It comes from the goddess of greed, of the goddess of destructivity. There's this inner marketing, advertising dynamic that the mind is made for us, so we can pursue our objective to separate from God. And you don't want to go to the fourth dimension, believe me. That's where the search is intensified. That is really, you're going to find yourself attenuated to a horrific degree. Very, very attenuated. You're going to turn into like a gray alien at some point. You know, you'll be so attenuated that because the search will be spread out to such an extent that you'll feel so lost. You'll feel so dispirited. Really. And then you'll end up coming back to some third dimensional planet and trying to take it over, and you know, it just goes on and on and on. It's all madness. Madness. Like the gray aliens say, we are you in your future. You know, yeah, who wants to be that? Are you kidding me? You don't want to be a fourth dimensional. Want to be a fifth dimensional. The karma gurus lift you up into the fifth dimensional experience, where you begin to get used to this perpetual refreshment of everything in your environment. Everything is perpetually refreshed. It's like fountains, perpetual fountains, you know. Just, it's beautiful. So this is a real history lesson of what's happened. But in this aspiration, which was being, you know, championed by men, but also supported by a lot of women. They were tired of the search too. A lot of women were very tired in the 60s, said, forget this search. But the call of children and grandchildren and house and home, all this stuff is very powerful in women, very powerful. They have a hard time being adamantly vocal about dropping the search. Because they think about, wait a minute, if I drop the search, what about my children? What about my grandchildren? You know, where's my family? You know. Well, you're not going to have one, or it's going to be not going to be the same way for sure. So it's very difficult. Whereas men are able to be more footloose and fancy free about being adamant, like, you know, I don't care. I don't care at all about children, grandchildren, any of that stuff. Never had any thought for it whatsoever. Don't absolutely could care less. So I'm able to be more adamant. You know, where women are like, you know, like, wow, that's a tough one. You know. But they're still able to do it. So the targeting was largely towards men. And you see in all the advertising, the Holy Spirit's pointed this out to me, and it's still going on nonstop. The man is always the idiot in the advertising. He's always the bad guy. He's always the one that's causing the problem. Always the one that has the problem. Always the one that can't figure out. It's always the woman that comes in and solves the problem and says, gee, honey, or female voice, whatever. Gee, here's the answer. Oh, the man says, oh, you got the answer for me. This is the marketing campaign of the goddess of greed, the goddess of the search, 100% for sure this is a fact, and this is what intensifies your search and makes you feel that you need then to turn to glamour to motivate you. Turn to the feminine, which is the root of glamorizing and glamour, to aggrandize you and tell you, the cheerleader is saying, you can do it. You got to go out there and search harder. You got to make all your efforts greater. Fourth dimension. You'll end up attenuated like a gray alien. And then enslaved by reptilians. You'll end up there. That's the terrible wickedness of it all. So, the entire advertising campaign that has saturated this planet was really targeted at your aspiration to turn your search over, to drop your search. It's directly targeting that, even though you may have not, been quite aware of this. It's directly targeting that. Because this whole pyramid scheme of the Goddess of Greed is a pyramid scheme. It's a scam, a pyramid scam, right? Multi-level marketing. It's a multi-level pyramid marketing scam to get more and more recruits to suck all their energy up to the top so that the top gets totally enriched more and more and more and more and more. And they tell you that if the goddess at the top of this pyramid scam finally gets enough treasure, then all this treasure will come back to you. So it's not true. It never comes back to you. Just like a pyramid scam, you're doing all the hard work at the bottom and all your profits, everything are going up towards the top. And yet the top never, and it never ends because the top never finds the treasure either. All they do is they use their money to put more advertising campaigns on everyone. See? They spend the money, everything that you, energy you give to the Goddess of Greed comes back to you as a more intensified advertising campaign. Demonizing your aspirations to drop the search, making you search even harder. So it is a vicious, vicious circle that you're in, that we have been in. I've been in it, you're in it, I'm in it, but I'm getting out of it. Hopefully you're getting out of it too. You never find the treasure. You never get what you've been working for so hard. And so of course it's a bitter pill to swallow, which is why I say the mood of repentance is absolutely essential. You must recognize that you've been duped by the pyramid scheme of existence. Existence is nothing but a pyramid hoax. It's a pyramid scheme. Marketing the search for your treasure, which blinds you to the fact that you already are abiding in the one treasure. Everything is already abiding in. Everything shares the treasure. It's all treasure. All of creation is one vast treasure, ever expanding and increasing. It's all one vast treasure. There's nothing that is not completely blessed with total treasure. Nothing at all. Everything abides in this treasure. So, how can you search for it? To search for it is to deny it. The search is really a denial of your treasure. And all the while you think it's a search to find your treasure. No, it's a denial of your treasure. And so anything that is intensifying your search is causing greater denial of your treasure. And so all this pyramid scheme of existence and the Goddess of Greed at its apex, you're pumping everything up there, she disperses everything back as what? Marketing campaigns and pressure to intensify your search, which only intensifies your denial, which even makes you blinder than before. So, get the concept of the true karma guru. There are true karma gurus. The trustees, they will help wind down your search. They will de-intensify your search. You will overcome your valuing of the world and just say, I don't need the search. I'm willing to set the search down. Once we literally drop the search, our treasure is immediately apparent to us. We're aware of it. We're aware of the one treasure. But that only comes when we're from a de-intensification of the search. You're not going to just drop your search. You're not going to be some super intense seeker or searcher and then just drop it. The continuity is too abrupt. It's too abrupt for you. It's too abrupt for anyone. So you have to de-intensify it first. And eventually, you'll get to the point when where you're able to just set it down entirely. But that's something that will come about once the search gets de-intensified. So let's not worry about when's that going to happen. That's the mood of a search too. Don't worry about when is it going to happen. Just take the steps to get there. Just take the steps to get there. Focus on the steps to get there. Turn all your karma over to the karma, all of it. See, the good karma is just the stuff we think is helping us in our seeking, find the treasure. See, this stuff's helpful for me finding the treasure. That's quote-unquote good karma. The quote-unquote bad karma is the stuff that we think is hurting our seeking, it's ineffective seeking. Now, both effective and ineffective seeking blind us to our treasure and our denial of the treasure. You might say our good karma is even worse, because that's the stuff to think, this is effective, this is good for me. That intensifies it, right? So you might even say it's worse, perpetuates it more, right? This is the real apex teaching. This is the real Ati Yoga. This is the true teaching. So I'm able to share this and pass it on, but I am not a karma guru. Forget it. Absolutely not. I'm in need of, giving my karma to a karma guru. But I'm aware of having been through. I'm aware of this situation. So just heads up to everybody. Heads up to everybody, which is what the purpose of YouTube is a heads up. People sharing what they know with the world. That's the whole point of it all. And, heads up is a good thing. It's a really good thing. So we're about to have this fourth dimensional push take place. And that's a really bad thing. So at the same time, we have this fifth dimensional push taking place, which I'm representing here in these videos, is a push towards to leapfrog over the fourth dimensional situation. To leapfrog into a situation where your seeking is de-intensified. Why? Because everything around you seems so precious and beautiful and wonderful, you don't even feel like you need to go anywhere to find something. Because you say, wow, I feel like everything is finding me. I feel like my treasure is finding me. I feel like I'm being found. Fifth dimension is where you feel like you're being found. It's not where you're finding something, it's where you're being found. Like, my treasure is finding me. And eventually, when you drop the search altogether, you realize that there's no way you can ever be separate from your treasure at all. So, but again, that gradually comes about as your search de-intensifies, as you feel like your treasure is finding you. That's a de-intensification, right? Not that you have to go find it, it's finding you. And that's the grace of the guru. You give your karma to the karma guru, all of it, it comes back as the grace of God, where you feel that your treasure is finding you without you needing, to search for it, okay? So, hopefully this is a good postscript to Ison. And again, whatever happens with Ison, we are on the verge of this fourth dimensional situation. And you want to avoid that at all costs. All right, and what I've seen, most people in the world will not avoid it, okay? Most people have too much seeking momentum, searching momentum to avoid it. And maybe some of you watching the video are going to still have too much, but if you go into it with this awareness here, this type of awareness, like, hey, it's going to be super good for you, actually. It's going to be very helpful. Very, very helpful. Because you may not be swept away by the main current. You may drift a little ways on the side of the banks, and then you're able to actually free yourself. As a matter of fact, I saw in a dream that's what's going to happen to me to some extent. Is I'll drift a little bit downstream, but I'm so close to the banks, I'm able to go onto the land, as it were, away out of the current of the river, and get to the fifth dimension. So I may drift down a little ways, time-wise. In fact, that's what I saw happening. So that's okay. That's okay. So don't freak out if you're not liberated right away. Don't freak out, okay? Just get closer to the bank, away from the main current, okay? Get more and more away from the main current. And you may find yourself dwelling in a beautiful place, actually, where, again, it feels like your treasure is finding you. Wherever you go, this treasure is finding you. And don't freak out that you're still, that the fourth dimensional shift is happening. Don't freak out about it, all right? So I'll be able to help you out with that, because I probably will be going through that situation myself. That's how I see it. Now, maybe it'll be better than that. I don't think it's going to be worse than that. And if you can catch the drift of what's being said here, then I guarantee you, you are in a very fortuitous situation. If you can catch this drift, you just catch it, say, yeah, I got a sense of this. I kind of got a sense, overall gestalt-like sense of what's being said. Gestalt is kind of like talking about perceptual patterns, how we can have like various blocks of things, and then our mind's able to put it together, like we various things around in a circle-like thing. But the sphere is not really there, but we sort of intuit a sphere because of the outline various, you know, dots, like we put a dot, 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 dash, dash, dash in a circle. We intuit the circle. So we have this perceptual capacity to intuit wholeness from pieces. And this is gestaltness coming from, I think, the Berlin School of Germany. And so in this video, you may see these various pieces of what's being said. And then you get this overall sort of gestalt-like wholeness of feeling like, ah, I kind of get the sense of the overall picture. That's good. That's very fortuitous. Instead of, if you're still like this part and this part, and why do they mean this? That's not so fortuitous. But if you just get this sense, like, what's the whole picture here? What's the gestalt of it? Don't worry about all the pieces. What is it pointing to? What is the overall big picture? What is it pointing to? Ah, okay. Get that sense, and don't try to make it too exact. Just get this sort of diffuse overall feeling of it. And you say, I'm going to be okay. I'm going to de-intensify my search. I'm going to drop my search. That leads to the death-free realm where everything is perpetually fresh. I'm going to allow my treasures to find me. My treasures to find me. I'm not finding them. They're finding me. I'm going to allow that. I'm going to give all my karma to the karma guru, the good and the bad and the ugly, all of it, and let that come. Let the guru act as a trustee, and see this overall sense of getting free of the search, because the search blinds us to the one treasure. And overall, just say, yeah, I kind of get this overall. That is very fortuitous for you, for sure. And we may go down the stream a little bit, but we'll get to the other side and get out of that terrible stream of searching that just continuously sweeps us away in turmoil. Rapids, you know, waterfalls, rapids, constant suffering and turmoil. Horrible. We're tired of it. And I would hope those that were so tired of it during the 60s and the 70s, and those younger people coming in who are also very tired of it, will hear this, you know, and say, hey, you know, there's something being shared here which has got an overall gestalt sense of the whole big picture thing. And it's not too late. We can de-intensify our search. We can do it. We don't have to, you know, just be a subset of the fourth dimension. That's not where it's at. It's not where it's at all. We can have a way higher destiny, death-free realm. I guarantee you, it's simple. Piece of cake once you see it. Not shocking at all. Not shocking at all. Once you drop your search, or get close to dropping your search, you can then see the conditions of the death-free realm. You say, ah, of course. There's no search there. you see? There's no search there. So there's no reason to see anything without treasure. So everything is a treasure. Your treasure is... Of course, it's easy. Once your church de-intensifies to a certain level, it's easy to see the death-free realm is of course, not a problem for me. Doesn't bother me. Let your treasure find you. Be found by your treasure. That's it. Very great.